Rob Ash Show with your host, Mick Traer, and Drakehead football coach, Rob Ash. Show is brought to you by Suburban Mitsubishi, right on the corner, right on the price, right on 90th and Hickman, Des Moines.
Hi everyone, and welcome to the Rob Ash TV show. I'm Mick Traer, along with Drake football coach Rob Ash and a smiling Rob Ash. 21-0, the final score. The Bulldogs pick up a win on the road, and a good win for Drake.
That's right, Mick. It just felt tremendous to win, and to win decisively, and to have a great shutout by our defense. And, you know, with an 8-hour bus ride coming home, it's the way to go.
I know there's got to be some more things we could probably say about Drake, but defensively, another game for the Bulldogs, played super defense.
Well, you know, it's tough to shut out any college football team these days, and our defense got it done. It's the first shutout in our Division III program, first one at Drake in about 10 years. And not only that, they scored a touchdown, the defense did. I think our defensive unit was determined to win.
Shut out a football team that's a good football team, a big football team. I know you're a little surprised with the size.
Well, we saw it on paper, 6'4", 290, 6'3", 285, that type of thing. But, Mick, you wouldn't believe how big they were until they actually walked out on the field. It was the first two or three plays were very intimidating because of their size. But our guys rose to the challenge, and we hit them pretty solidly before the game was over.
Coach, I know some things happened throughout the football game that Wisconsin-Oshkosh didn't want to happen. I know they didn't want to get to a situation where they had to throw the football. But that's what happened in the second half when they got behind.
Well, I tell you, it was a perfect game plan for us because it worked out our way. We ended up in the second half with a 14-point lead. They wanted to run the football, but they couldn't because we were making it a little tough for them. It would have taken too long for them to try to catch up. So the second half was kind of strange. We were doing what we didn't want to do, which was try to run against their big team because we wanted to run out the clock. They were doing what they didn't want to do, which was trying to throw. And it was beautiful to watch because it was in our favor.
Rob, what does a win on the road mean for the Drake program right now?
Any win is a big win, Mick, when you're having a season like we are. And that was tremendous because we do have two more road games at the end of the season. I think it's a fabulous boost for us coming into our game against Milliken this week. We still have a chance to end up with a 500 season. Everything's real positive right now. It was a great weekend.
Well, it was a great weekend for the Drake Bulldogs. They picked up a 21-0 win over Wisconsin Oshkosh. And we'll be back to take a look at the highlights of that football game in a moment.
Captain, I feel good. I knew that I would not. I feel good. I knew that I would not. So good, so good. I got it. Oh, so good, so good. Cause I got it.
Delivery time of gasoline, diesel fuel, and motor oil supplies is crucial to Iowa industry. Timely personal service and quality Conoco products at an affordable price that service professionals and their customers can depend on. Parker Oil Company of Des Moines, Iowa.
Did you know that over half the new cars sold by Suburban Mitsubishi are made by Americans just 100 miles from Iowa? That Iowa has a positive trade balance with Japan? The Mitsubishi Corporation has a trade representative from Japan living in Iowa and working to improve Iowa's exports to Japan. If you've been looking for a reason to buy an automobile with a Japanese name, a reason in addition to outstanding quality and dependability, come to Suburban Mitsubishi. Smart cars for smart car buyers.
Welcome back to the Rob Ash Show. Coach, before we take a look at the highlights of this football game, I guess we should explain a little bit about the field conditions that you had to play with.
That's right, Mick. We left a sunny day here in Iowa and drove up to Wisconsin on Friday afternoon. And as we got closer to Oshkosh, the skies got gray and it began to snow. It snowed all afternoon, about an inch and a half, and we were unable to practice. The fields were covered with snow. And to make matters worse, they had a high school game on the Oshkosh field Friday night. So when we got up Saturday morning, the fields were in pretty bad shape, although it was a bright sunny day.
Indeed it was. Let's take a look at the highlights of this football game. And it was homecoming for Wisconsin Oshkosh, and that brings in a lot of people, I guess.
Well, they had a great crowd, and as you can see, it was a bright, sunny day, but it was about 38 or 39 degrees, and between the hash marks, the field was quite muddy. The circumstances of the game were kind of tedious at the beginning. They had all these ceremonies, very enjoyable, I'm sure, for the spectators, but we were down underneath the stadium waiting. The game was delayed, starting by about 6 or 7 minutes. Our team got very much on edge, and Wisconsin Oshkosh came out very aggressively at the beginning of the game. They had two runs that were got several yards, and then they ran this bootleg pattern. Their fullback came out of the backfield, was wide open, and they got down into our territory right away. It was a tough moment, but our defense held. Here's a good play here by Scott Sullivan, some other guys on the defense coming up to put Oshkosh in a fourth down situation. They tried to run the option, and Dale Plussel there comes off the guy who was blocking him and makes a great individual effort to stop Oshkosh on fourth and five. So it gave us the ball. We came right back with Don Sewing on our first play of the game. A new play we had put in for this week. It worked very well. We got Don the ball more, and he was more effective. Here's DeWitt on the toss. You can see him slipping as he tries to go around the corner, but he got some good yardage, and we were up. We were outmanned as far as weight up front, Nick, but we blocked real well, and Don Sewing and DeWitt ran real hard and got us going at the beginning of the game. We got into a long yardage situation here on third down. We threw all the way down the field to Chad Briley. Their free safety misjudged the ball and actually hit Chad right in the chest, but it was a difficult play, and so we had to punt the ball away. Our defense by this time realized, because of Oshkosh's great size, we were going to have to use quickness to try to stop them. They had a good play there on first down, got a hand on that football there that would have been a dangerous pass to their tight end, and I believe that took us out of that drive there. So our defense, after getting off to a little bit of a slow start, now is starting to rise to the occasion. Oshkosh got the ball back after we failed to move it on our second possession, and you can see the pressure was really good. We caused a fumble, and David Schnothorst, number 20, with his exceptional quickness, was able to get in and get the football for us. Here's a toss to DeWitt, real nice run. Once he got outside the hash marks, you could actually have a little footing, and he got a good gain there. Then Blake Pilgrim on a bootleg finds Jeff Brieger. He's open deep, and just as he was about to catch the ball, they tackled him. It was pass interference. That moved the ball on down into Oshkosh's territory. So we're trying to capitalize here on the fumble recovery by Schnothorst. Got ourselves into a second long situation, and we got a screen pass to Don Sewing. He nearly always makes the first guy miss, and that's really a great advantage. We got us down deep, and then we got down to the goal line. Watch him bring the pressure here. We run a bootleg. Blake does a great job getting his feet under him on a slippery turf, and Jeff Brieger was wide open for the touchdown. That was a great big play because they had actually had a little better offense in the whole first quarter, but they hadn't scored. Then there was a turnover, two or three big plays, and we were on the board.
Notice the Bulldogs certainly getting a lot of time for the passer.
Given the fact that they blitzed all those people, it was remarkable that Blake had that much time. Maybe the turf slowed them down a little bit too. Oshkosh came back, tenneled with a big sack. We twisted on the outside, and Steve did a good job taking advantage. You can see the pressure here again by our defensive unit, giving the quarterback no chance to throw the ball. Scott Sullivan tracking down the tight end and knocking the football away. Again, it was a matter of our defensive quickness to trying to offset their size. Here's Don Sewing with another really good run. It's a run-to-daylight type of play. He can go inside or outside, and that time he made a good decision. We also tried to use some quick passes to Sean Diggs. That ankle tackle right there, leg tackle, prevented a huge play, but it got us a first down. Now he had an unfortunate play due to the slippery field. Blake's throwing to Chad Briley. It's not easy to see on the tape, but Chad slipped. He was wide open in front of that defender. He just went down, and the ball went right in the defender's midsection for an interception. Not really Blake's fault. Here, and Oshkosh sort of took advantage of that interception. Greg Gerlach with a real tough hit, though, on their running back, but they had good gain up the sideline. There was a lot of fraternity and sorority students there from Oshkosh. They were whooping it up, and they got the ball down in deep inside. Here's a key play in the game. We flushed the quarterback out on a bootleg. Their tight end reversed his field, came across. Could have been a touchdown, but he slipped and fell right as the ball was getting there, and he missed. Could have been a touchdown, obviously, but they had to line up and play again. And then we had the pressure inside. Sullivan makes a tackle on the ball carrier on the draw. And now they try a little shotgun and dash play. Again, good pressure on the quarterback. It rushed his throw, it was overthrown, and we were able to get the ball back one more time. So the defense made a real good stand right there. We come back right away after the defensive stand. Blake found Jeff Brieger over the middle. We thought we were in pretty good shape to run out the clock in the first half, but they made a real good hit on DeWitt and popped the ball loose. And for the second time in two possessions, our defense had to come out on the field. This was the critical part of the game for us after these two turnovers, Mick. Both times they came back with a good run, you know, and down the sideline. You saw the one before, now this one. They've got offensive momentum. We had caused both these problems with offensive turnovers. You can see they're all the way down here to the 10-yard line, and another time for a key defensive stop. They had a 10-yard holding penalty. They tried a little screen pass here that was batted away by Tenold, and Dave Schnothorst, who was in the backfield, intercepted that ball. A cameraman missed it, but Schnothorst intercepted it. So two times in a row, our defense made the stop after offensive turnovers, and we went into the halftime with a 7-0 lead.
They certainly like to run the ball, and they get into the situation where they have to pass. They don't feel as comfortable, do they?
They were a running football team, and you know it was very important for us to be able to, you know, to get a lead and be ahead so that it would force them to pass the football. That's not what they really wanted to do. 7-0 halftime felt real good. We came out at the start of the second half continuing to run our fullback, and we told our offense it wasn't good enough and we could not have any more turnovers. We wanted to try to do something right away to start the second half, and this is a great drive. DeWitt White follows Don Sewing's run with another good run off tackle, and then we get the motion to the one back play. This is about a 3rd and 10 play, and Blake finds DeWitt open down the sideline, a play we've used many times this season with great success. Takes the ball down to the 2-yard line. They stopped us on first down. On second down, I wanted to get the touchdown. I called a halfback pass. It's a pretty ugly play, Mick, but it worked. they got on DeWitt sooner than I thought, but Jeff Brieger was wide open behind him, even though there were about 6 defenders back there. And 14-0 lead. Now, you see, we'd come out of halftime 7-0. It's been 5 minutes played already in the second half. Oshkosh has not even seen the football yet, and they're down 14-0. That was outstanding and really boosted our entire team on the sidelines. There's Scott Sullivan making another tackle. I think this took Oshkosh a little bit out of their game plan. You can see they're still trying to run the football, but our defense is starting to get better at responding to the off-tackle plays. There's two of the wives that went along, coaches' wives that went along on the trip. We were outnumbered, though, in the stands. Here's a big play. They completed a pass, but Mark Simon strips the receiver of the ball down deep, and Mark made the recovery himself. So they had a big play, and they were taken away by our defense with a great stop. We could not move the ball. We punted to them. They still tried to pound the ball into the boundary, but Brian Wanchek and Tony Iacobino come up with a stop. And they come back here, trying to throw the football. Here's Tenold coming in. Watch this play. Tony Smothers, a senior defensive lineman, lineman's dream.
He's
intercepts
going.
The ball. He's going. I thought he was going to run out of bounds here, but I guess he wanted to just make it last as long as he could. Now
let's
watch
see
it.
That again.
The top of the screen. Tenold comes in. Quarterback doesn't see him. The ball popped right into Tony's hands. The referee and Tony Iacobino are both just sort of coasting there, and Tony Smothers made it in. Tony's a senior, has worked real hard to get his playing time, and he's one of those guys that's just hung in there. And I couldn't think of a guy on a team that I'd be happier for scoring a defensive touchdown. Tony's just done great things for us, and that really boosted our spirits on the sideline, especially because it was Tony. It was a great play. And Steve Tenold, of course, caused it. Of course, he reminded Tony of that when they got on the sideline. Give Oshkosh credit. They came right back and sort of took advantage of our defense. You know, our defense scored, and then they had to go right back out on the field again because, of course, we had to give the ball back. I think we were a little flat, and Oshkosh completed 4 passes in a row. He got down inside the 20 one more time. But here's another great defensive play. Greg Gerlach with the interception. He hangs onto the ball and gets us out of trouble. Once again, Nick, you know, Oshkosh was not a passing team, and even though they completed a few passes, it's not their style. You know, they were prone to some mistakes because they don't pass as often, you know, in all their other games as they had to in this game. So we go into the fourth quarter with a 21-point lead.
21-0 at this point. You don't mind giving them a little yardage in the pass play.
We gave them the short passes the rest of the game. We also pulled the reins in on our own offense. We don't have much offense to show here for the fourth quarter because we ran the ball, we ran the clock. We stayed in bounds. We didn't want to throw incomplete passes, and defense continued to play well. Scott Sullivan on the sack there. By the end of the game, I'm sure their quarterback Miller was sore because we got after him, hit him several times. You know, he was throwing the ball just about every play as the game wore on. Here's a key play here. Mark Simon comes up from behind. Their receiver caught the ball. Mark just took it away from him, and you know, that was a great. That took away their last threat. They would have had the ball at the 20. Their quarterback stepped up and said something to the official, who promptly threw a flag. Got the ball out to the 35. We ran for a first down and punted them deep, and they didn't have any more chances. Here's another good sack by our defense later on in the fourth quarter. That's Kevin Beveridge, who got that pressure. Came down now late in the game, 4 minutes left, fourth down and two with a 21-point lead. They're trying to pound the ball for the first down, and just to add, you know, a little extra icing on the cake, our defense stopped them there on the fourth and two play. Actually, they might have lost yardage, and our offense got the ball back. We put in all the second team guys and ran out the clock.
21-0, another great defensive performance by the Bulldogs, and this one by everybody.
Well, it was a tremendous team effort. You know, we had different people who came through, different people on sacks and pass breakups and interceptions, and it was very impressive.
Let's take a look at the statistics of the football game. Even with a 21-0 victory, it looks the other way, like Oshkosh should have been leading.
You know, statistics are very misleading about this football game. You know, our defense allowed a lot of passing yardage in the second half that were just short passes that we kept in front of us because we were protecting the lead. Our offense didn't have a lot of yardage or a lot of big plays because we were protecting the ball for the bulk of the second half of the game. So I don't even care about those, Mick. The important thing is the one that we won. The big key too is the turnovers. They had we had three interceptions of their passes, and they also had three fumbles. So it was six turnovers for Oshkosh.
And a hard-hitting football game too.
It really was. They were big. And, you know, our guys really decided to take it to them. And both sides of the ball, we did. We hung in there pretty well.
Well, let's name our Suburban Mitsubishi players of the game, offensively and defensively.
Our offensive player of the game is Blake Pilgrim. Blake has really had an excellent comeback from a rocky start to the year. The captain, he had by far his best game so far this year. He was 8 for 11. Great passing efficiency, excellent job of running our offense, making the audibles at the line, and in the fourth quarter, running the clock out. Scott Sullivan, our other player of the week, inside linebacker, really spearheaded our defensive effort both against the run and the pass. And it's kind of interesting, Mick, that these two players of the week are our two captains. They really rose to the occasion in this particular game.
Well, it was a hard-hitting football game, Drake winning at 21-0. We'll be back with more of the Rob Ash Show right after this.
Good times with friends, hey, they're special. Sometimes you wish they would never end. The care you show is just as special. Friends know when to say when.
The family of Budweiser Beers is proud of all the friendships they've helped make. So when they remind you to know when to say when, it's all in the name of friendship.
Friends know when to say when.
Sam Siegel, his wife Annette, daughters Elise and Marlene, and grandchildren Michael, Risa, and Mikey invite you to join them and all the employees at Home Plastics in supporting the Drake Bulldogs all season long. This fall, there's exciting nonstop action and entertainment when the Bulldogs hit the field. Take your family to all the games. Sam does. There are two names Des Moines can count on: Home Plastics and Drake University. To make a great Sunday brunch, start with a great view. Add something colorful and healthy. And don't forget to add something a little sinful. Add something steamy and delicious and really pile it on. Then make sure you add the right stuff, like good friends. Sunday morning at the Capitol View Dining Room. Brunch at the Best Western Starlight Village downtown once, and you'll be back for more.
Welcome back to the Rob Ash Show. Coach, certainly on Saturday, there are a lot of good performances by the Bulldogs, probably some personal best for this year. A lot of kids played well.
That's really right, Mick. This team has been so tremendous to work with this season. We've had a lot of disappointing times and some heartbreaking losses, but they've continued to come out and play, and nobody's quitting. They all are coming up with increasingly good performances to get us back on track.
We're always looking for some of the players, of course, that don't get the recognition, and I think sometimes you're going to find those most likely in the offensive or defensive part of the line.
That's right. Linemen don't get anywhere near the recognition they deserve, and it's kind of nice to be able to get them with their helmets off and get a chance to get to know them a little more personally.
David Alders is the person we need to talk about today. Kid, this really a hard-nosed kid, does a lot of things for you.
Well, he's an excellent down defensive tackle for us, and David's a captain, you know, and doesn't get near the attention that Scott Sullivan and Blake Pilgrim, the other two captains, do because he plays in the line and in there where nobody can see him. And he also kind of suffers from, you know, playing in Dale Plessel's shadow. Dale makes a few more obvious plays sometimes, but the two of them have been side by side for 3 years, and they're a great tandem, and Buck has done a good job for us.
Well, it's an opportunity to talk with David.
The Rob Ash Show Player Close-Up is brought to you by Home Team Pizza.
Junior, we had a fairly decent season. We went 6-4. It wasn't what we expected, but personally I felt that it was kind of a personal accomplishment that I achieved playing in all 10 games and earning another varsity letter.
Tell us.
Being a senior is kind of a role that most teams need, because there's on most football teams there are less seniors than there are underclassmen as far as freshmen, sophomore, and juniors, and those players need someone to look up to that's already been through 3 years of football. And I feel that a lot of times a team's success depends on how the seniors bring and pull the rest of the team through the season by showing them leadership and how to do things the right way and setting a good example. And being a captain, I feel it's a great honor, because I never really thought I'd be a captain. Being elected by the rest of your teammates, it's a great personal accomplishment for myself. Being a captain, you have to come out every day and practice and work hard and set an example, because if the rest of the team sees a captain come out dogging it and having a bad practice, that it's easy for younger guys to follow in right behind him. And being a captain, it just keeps my spirits up. I got the nickname Uncle Buck from the movie Uncle Buck and John Candy. I've always drove big cars, there have always been beaters. I've always loved the Cubs, and there was a player in the past who just out of the blue one day at practice started calling me Uncle Buck, and it just stuck. My sister ended up having a baby, and then I became an uncle, and things kind of just fell in place.
Chill out tonight with Home Team Pizza's Larger Large Special, a delicious 16-inch pizza with your choice of topping for only $7.99, and that's with free delivery. So call right now to any Home Team Pizza location.
Did you know that over half the new cars sold by Suburban Mitsubishi are made by Americans just 100 miles from Iowa? That Iowa has a positive trade balance with Japan. The Mitsubishi Corporation has a trade representative from Japan living in Iowa and working to improve Iowa's exports to Japan. If you've been looking for a reason to buy an automobile with a Japanese name, a reason in addition to outstanding quality and dependability, come to Suburban Mitsubishi. Smart cars for smart car buyers.
Welcome back to the Rob Ash Show. Well, Coach, it's time to put the Wisconsin Oshkosh on the back burners and trying to kind of move ahead. And this week it's Milliken, but it's a home game for the Bulldogs, and that's good news.
Well, it is nice to be back, Mick. Although we weren't very successful at home earlier in the season, it's nice to have an opportunity to come back and try to do better. We were playing a great team, but it's going to be a tough game, but I hope we can pull off a win for our home fans.
Coach, last year it took one of the better performances by the Drake Bulldogs to pick up a win on the road. You think that's what it'll take again this year?
There's no question about it. Milliken was preseason polls was rated in the top five, the third in one poll, fifth in another poll nationally. They've got an outstanding program. Actually would have been in the national playoffs last year, except they lost to Drake. And so they have something to shoot for, and they, you know, they're bringing in a real good team.
Rob, they're 4-2 on the year, and they've stubbed their toe a couple of times this year. Let's take a look at the schedule here.
We're surprised that they're not undefeated at this point, although their league, Mick, is probably one of the toughest leagues in the country this year in Division III. Carroll is a very fine program, always plays close, low-scoring games, and Milliken usually has some trouble with them. You see, that was a loss, 13-7, and they lost to Illinois Wesleyan, who's undefeated so far this year, 2 weeks ago, 27-24. In the Wesleyan game, Illinois Wesleyan scored on a 4th-and-5 play with about 2 minutes left in the game to win. Milliken does have an outstanding win against Wheaton. Wheaton's only loss of the year was to Milliken, and Wheaton beat Augustana this past weekend. Augustana, of course, is a preseason pick to go into the national playoffs, and I mean that league, it's dog eat dog every week. So those two losses shouldn't be underestimated.
Well, certainly a win by the Bulldogs this Saturday would be a big win for your program this year.
Well, no question about it. As you look at our schedule preseason, you look at Dayton being the top team we're going to play, Nebraska Wesleyan, and then Milliken and Simpson, those kind of people being national playoff type people, it's one of our top games.
Milliken, I think, kind of reminds you of a little bit of a Dayton. They have a lot of different weapons. They have some speed, and they like to run the football.
Well, the great football teams, Mick, are always able to run the football and stop the run. And Milliken can run the football. They run an option attack. They have a big fullback. They have a quick quarterback. They have a real speedy tailback. And to top it all off, they have a fast wide receiver. And that speed at the skill positions and the hard running football is tough. Defensively, they play a 6-1 tilt, the Michigan State tilt defense. They're really aggressive against the run. You have to be able to spread them out with the passing game.
Is this a ball game of the Bulldog defense against their offense? How do you stop them?
Well, you know, we have to stop the fullback. You know, they've got all this pizzazz on the outside with the option and the pass, but they don't really want to beat you that way. They want to beat you with the safe inside run play to the fullback. And you have to stop that fullback first. Make them pitch the ball several times. Hope they'll drop one once in a while. And make sure the guy on the outside, when he catches the ball, doesn't take it all the way for a touchdown. We're pretty good at that, and I hope we can come through in this game.
Certainly offensively, I think Blake Pilgrim, just watching him throw the football on film up at Wisconsin Oshkosh, getting a lot more confidence in his throw, especially when he's throwing to the sidelines.
Well, Blake's really progressed. You know, I think he put a lot of pressure on himself early in the season, played tight, you know, and wasn't in there for a while. When he came back, I think he just said, hey, I got nothing to lose now. I got a second chance. A lot of guys don't get a second chance, and he's playing a lot more relaxed now, and he's been very effective. I think he's doing a real good job.
Jamie D'Angelo saw some action in the fourth quarter on Saturday.
That's right. We're in great situation now at quarterback, Mick. We have two guys, both Blake and Jamie, who are healthy. Both of them have game experience. Both of them can play. I think we'll be able to go to both of them or either of them, depending on injuries or whatever this week. But Blake certainly is going to start.
What do you think the difference has been in the Bulldog defense? Certainly, it's been about 3 or 4 weeks in a row. They have really played well, and you got to go and ask them to stop another fine offensive team again this week.
Well, it's really tough on the defense to keep playing these good football teams. I think the reason that the point production has gone down is we've been a little more careful with the football. Our kicking game has improved a little bit, and you know those kinds of things help the defense. But in the same sense, I think what's happened too is their confidence is increasing game by game, and that's making a big difference. We're making real aggressive plays on defense, and people feel good about what they're doing. We know what the guys can do, and all those things are fitting together.
Certainly Dayton could run the option against the Bulldogs at times. Does that worry you?
Absolutely. Milliken has the same big play potential that Dayton did. And anytime you run option, there's a threat of the big play. And we've got to do a better job against the option than we did against Dayton.
Sure, you probably mentioned it to a few of the seniors that it's going to be their last home game maybe on Saturday.
That's right. It is their last home game. And, you know, we're going to try to use that as an incentive. We know Milliken has the incentive since we beat them a year ago. Our incentive has to be to try to show our fans at home in the last home game for our seniors the kind of football that we know our team can play and hopefully get a win.
Coach, do you think a high scoring game where the Bulldogs have to score, you know, as high as they do or try and hold the scoring down?
Well, I've been wrong on my predictions on scoring all year long. You know, I assume this will be a low-scoring football game. I don't know. You know, each team has some big play potential. I don't know that we can hold Milliken to 0 or 7 points. I imagine it'll be in the teens, and hopefully we'll have a good offensive day and keep up with them.
But I think there's one point that the Bulldogs have made as of late is they can play with anybody.
No question about it, Mick. After playing a great game against Dayton, great game against Nebraska Wesleyan, Hope still has a great season. We played Simpson tough. They're undefeated. I mean, we've played a lot of good teams, and we've been in every game, or won every game, you know, right up to the last minute. We're not intimidated by or afraid of anybody, but we know it'll still be a good game.
Should be an exciting football game coming up this Saturday as the Bulldogs take on Milliken. Hope to see you out there. We hope to see you back here next week for the Rob Ash Show.